All right.
Time now for our Miami Bureau Chief. Let's go to Miami, where Bruce Smirnoff is standing by.
Hi, David.
Earlier in the show, we had Fred Stoller on the program.
I love Fred.
And he said you gave him a Seinfeld episode.
Of course.
I want to hear your version of that story.
Well, before I tell the story, I think Fred is one of the few people I gave financial advice to, and I think he followed it. I think he's, you know, because he makes a nice living. He's in like a million things. And I said, put it away, put, you know, a segment of your money away. And I think he really got into that. So fortunately for him, I think he's going to retire very famous and very wealthy. So that's a good story.
Good.
Now the bad one. So in, I think I started lifting weights in, I was really skinny. And I think around 89, I started doing heavy-duty weightlifting, and I outgrew my suits. Did he talk anything about it? Did he say
yes,
anything?
Yes.
Okay. So I had these two nice Armani suits that I bought, and I had to give them away because I was now like a 42 long where I used to be a 40 long. And it's very hard to find people our size. So I knew Fred was tall and skinny. I mean, wasn't known to be one to dress up, but still I didn't want to give them to Goodwill because they were too good to give away. So I called him up. I said, look, I got two suits. I want to get rid of them. I'll give them to you. It's that simple. And he goes, all right, fine. And I give them to him, and they're black suits, and they were very nice. And he goes, what can I do to pay? I go, I don't want anything. I just want to make sure they go to, you know, you rather than some homeless guy that's going to urinate in the month first 20 minutes that he puts it on. So he goes, how about I buy you a meal? I said, fine, you can buy me a meal. So that's the deal. And I think like about 5 days later, he calls me. And remember I told you last show about watching Larry Hagman's liver get flown in to Sinai because we were at Jerry's Deli. Well, it was like we used to sit at the same place. I used to always like to sit right in the front. So he calls me, goes, I'm
They were flying the liver in fresh for Jerry's.
Yeah, it was in one of those, you know, lunch buckets where they pour the ice, and they had the surgery. They had all the media trucks there. So I don't believe it was the same time. I think the Larry Hagman's liver was later. But so this has got to be like 19, I don't know, let's say 91, 92. And Fred calls me, meet me at Jerry's Deli. Well, it's 11 o'clock at night. I go, I hang out late. So I show up there and he goes, I want to buy you your dinner. And I go, that's very nice of you. But I ate already. It's 11 o'clock at night. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to have a bowl of soup. But I don't want this to count as my meal. I mean, I wanted to give you this stuff for free, but you insisted on doing something. So you want to buy me a meal. This is not a meal. This is 11 o'clock at night. This is not the hours that you buy somebody dinner. So this is like you're throwing this in and that's it. You know, I didn't care, but of the laws, whatever the rules of buying somebody dinner, this was way out of And I just said it. It was like a matter-of-fact thing. I think I had mushroom and barley. Could have had matzo ball soup. Don't remember. It was not a big deal. And so about 3 years later, he's writing on Seinfeld, and I get this call from Mark Schwartz, I think his name was. And I went to BU with him, and he became like a giant casting director, and he was the casting director for Seinfeld. And they want me to read for this part, and they go, this was created – like kind of about you, it's your adventure with Fred Stoller. And I read the script and, you know, it's like word for word, you know, I'm going, hey, look at me, I'm pumped, you know, because I was showing him how big my biceps got and I couldn't fit into the suit and the whole. And so I'm very excited. And I went and I read with Mark Schwartz and Larry David. It was pretty powerful. And I was a little nervous, but I mean, all I had to do was be me. And I was, and they did not give me the part. They gave it to Steve Heitner, who became Banyan on the show. And he got like 13 reoccurring episode. So right. I'm very happy for him because Steve is very funny, Heitner, and he's been in a lot of movies, and he's had himself a great career. And you really have to know how to act. You know, being a stand-up is one thing. Acting, you know, it does require something else. So I don't harbor any bad feelings. I wish I had gotten the role. It would have been phenomenal, but that was just one of those things. But yes, that's a true story.
So
yes.
You actually auditioned
to play me.
And they gave
my part to Steve Heitner because he was a better me than I was. And that's, yes, if you want to look at it that way, that's the horror. But I try not to because I'm not addicted to any medication or pills. And if I think too much about these things, it could cause that. So we just kind of laugh it off and we go on to the next horror story.
What was the story with Carol O'Connor?
Oh, that's such a long one. You want that? We didn't talk about that one, did we? Boy, you must be really excited the way you just eased me in. That was like a Tom McCann shoehorn. you just had that in the back. You want that 11-minute juicy story. I could do that. I could tell you.
Well, some other time. Some other time. Okay. So what happened? How's Miami? Do you miss Los Angeles?
No, I miss all my friends, and I go back occasionally. Like I told you, I work for Don Casino Productions, and we're an agency that books cruise ships, and we're very popular and high agency. It's very nice working for them because I get treated with a lot of respect from all the artists. But we do a showcase at the Ice House now. We've done it 2 years in a row, so I get to come back, and I got to tell you, I left in 2001. And the traffic is even worse than it was in 2000. Just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, it's horrible. Even with the subway, which I was not there for. I know it opened up from downtown, I think, to Western Avenue or Vermont. Where does it go? Somewhere. And then it goes up Vermont, up to Hollywood mm-hmm. Boulevard. So I haven't seen that because I usually stay in Pasadena when we do the thing at the Ice House. But yeah, I don't miss L.A., but I miss my friends. Do you miss L.A.? You don't live there anymore, do you?
I don't live there anymore. I find Manhattan to be godless. It's all so transactional. It's hard to have real friends in Manhattan, but that's not true. That's just a phase I'm going through.
Yeah, and you live on like the Upper East Side. I lived in New York. I went from LA to New York for 2 years. I think we talked about this when mm-hmm. I went to Brooklyn. And the thing about all my friends were the comics, you know, at all the clubs and everything. And no one, I had this really cool place in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, and I wanted to have like guys over for Thanksgiving. I couldn't get, if I was giving away gold bullion, I couldn't get anybody to come to Brooklyn. I mean, maybe now they go to like, what is it, that area that they built under the, you know, the where the Jews live, Williamsburg and all the hipster areas. But you couldn't get anybody to come to Bay Ridge. I go, please, I'm getting a turkey. I got great pies and cakes. I can't go to Brooklyn. I can't go to Brooklyn. I mean, it's a subway ride, you know, but no. So I understand that. But yes, Manhattan, I was too old. I was when I moved to New York, you gotta be full of piss and vinegar to take the subways and schlep with the hot coat when it's cold out. And then you get in the subway and you start to sweat, all that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Where were we? What were you?
We were talking about Miami and what's going on in Miami.
Nothing. There's nothing going on here. This is where people come to retire and then they eventually die. You know, this is it. I mean, it's like this is the almost the end and the end. There's nothing. There's nothing prior to that. There's good restaurants. There's it's half true because when you say Miami, I don't live in Miami. I live in Delray Beach, so I'm 38 miles from there. When you talk about Miami, you're talking about South Beach. Yes, very exciting. It's very Spanish. It's very Cuban oriented. You are almost in another country. If you're young, you like to dance, you want to stay out late. It's wild. Mm-hmm. It's incredible. I'm reading books now about what Miami was like in the 70s, Miami Beach in the 70s. And it was a horror show. And then when the Marielitos were let out of out of Cuba. Castro emptied his mental institutions and his jails in 1980 because he was able to hoodwink Jimmy Carter into letting them out. And they, and you're talking about 100,000 or so hardcore mental patients and criminals going into like a 10-block area. So it was really just a horror zone. But then they've cleaned it up and it's become spectacular.
Great, great.
Now, let me let's go back to show business, because, I mean, I don't want you to – I don't want to divert anything. I have good stories. I just – the Carol O'Connor thing, I got to, like, wind myself up.
We'll do Carol O'Connor next time.
Right. But, like, I wanted to tell a story about – because I imagine – I'm getting some emails from people who listen to this on your podcast, and they're very complimentary. And I imagine a lot of them are artists. So I wanted to talk about, you know, some weird things I've seen in my career being, as I said, a fly on the wall. So I was friends with Bud Robinson, who, you remember Bud?
He
handled Doc Severinsen and a lot of famous acts. And Bud and I were friends, and Bud Friedman, it's weird to tell a story with two Buds, but there's Bud Friedman who owned the Improv and his wife, Alex. And we were all very friendly.
Why don't we say Bud Friedman and then Bud Light?
Okay, Bud Friedman and Bud Light. So Bud Light had a great apartment on Altaloma in West Hollywood. And he used to entertain a very fancy place and a lot of famous people living in the building. So whatever it was, one night Bud had us over for dinner and we're sitting at his dining room table. And this is 1981. And I'm going to say it's about January of 81. I'm 25 years old, so I'm a kid, and I'm innocent. I don't know the seedy side or the downside or the weird side. I started to experience it, but this is one of the things I experienced. So the doorman comes and says, Regis wants to come up. And we go, oh, Regis is coming. And they go, oh, who's Regis? They go, Regis Philbin. I go, wait a minute, Regis Philbin. I remember that name. It was on local news in LA. And then I think Joey Bishop had a show going up against Carson. And he was the sidekick. So I go, oh, I'd love to meet this guy. And in walks this very handsome. He's only about, did I tell you this story?
No.
The door opens up and in walks very handsome man. And these people were all Bud Robinson, Bud Light, Bud Friedman, the whole trip. Everybody was like 50 years old. I'm 25. And in comes Regis, and he was about 50 years old. And he sits down at the table and they introduce me. And, you know, we were talking for about 2 minutes. And then all of a sudden he starts to cry, Regis. And I mean crying to where very, you know, sobbing, and his body was shaking, and he's saying, my life is over, it's all over, I had an audition, it didn't come through, and it's all over for me. And I've never, you know, we all think these things, but we all have sadness, but I've never seen a grown-up cry like this, and it was very sad to see this. And I watched Bud and Bud Friedman try to comfort him, and Alex too, you know, doing every, hey, Reed, you know, riding high in April, shot down in May, you never know where life is going to, and he was just, no, this is it. And it was just so impactful to see this. And I got to tell you, for you show business people living, about 4 months later, where he thought this was the end of his world, he got that morning show, and need I tell you how famous he became and how, you know, popular he was. And I was there for like a very bad moment of his career, but thank God it was just temporary. And whenever people say my career is over, I'm never going to get an opportunity again, I always tell these stories. They're very inspirational, you know.
It's inspirational, but he's amazing. He might be the greatest broadcaster who ever did it.
That's right.
Right?
That's right. And this could have been 2 hours of his life that were just, you know what I mean? I just happened to be in this man's worst 2 hours of his life. And but I had never met him before. So this is how I meet him at the bottom. And then look where he is now. He was supposed to be down here with Don Rickles just like a month ago, but Don, you know, passed away. But, you know, still vibrant, still performing, still like one of the greatest TV personalities of all time. Yeah.
Still looks great. And he got rejected. He was given another opportunity, and he made it work because he wanted it. I mean, if you react that way, if you're crying in front of friends about being rejected, this guy obviously wanted it more than anybody else. Isn't that a key component of success, wanting it that badly that you would break down and cry over losing an audition?
Don't know. No. I mean, the wanting it real badly is one thing. I think almost everybody who's in the business wants it real badly, but it's the execution. I mean, I always use Jerry Seinfeld as an example. I mean, I never hung out with him, but the people that I know that hang out with him to talk about his work habits, and that they were like, you know, they were incredible, where, you know, no fooling around, no kibitzing with people, just go home, do the writing. Woody Allen, the same thing. These people just sit down and they don't do anything until they get the work done. And a lot of people are BSers. And I guess I have to say I was one of them, where I wanted to be real popular and famous, but I don't know if I actually applied myself. I have to say
that. But then there are people who don't apply themselves. I mean, Rickles didn't apply himself. He wasn't sitting, working. He just went on stage and did it.
Correct. Yeah. Yeah. Well, he probably had the balls, you know, where he could insult people like that, where I can sit and try to break these things down. I always try to blame myself and find out where did I lack? And I know I'm not a great writer. I'm a good comic and stuff, but I would sit down. I would say, I'm going to sit for 5 hours and I'm going to write jokes. And, you know, within minutes, my mind was wandering and I couldn't focus. You're a real writer. So do you have that problem when you sit? Can you sit for 3, 4, 5 hours?
Yeah, but I'm not writing stand-up. Stand-up is conversation. All my great jokes for stand-up are through conversation. Then there's the mechanics of writing jokes, but that's for other people and TV, where it's... Stand-up has to be authentic. You can't force authenticity onto the page. Although, I don't know. I there's a process for stand-up.
Well, some of these stand-ups, they're not authentic at all, but they're clever, they're observational. It's so amazing that when you talk about stand-up, it encompasses everything. You know who were some – when I worked at the Improv and I would see – these people come in. It was a guy, Michael Collier. Remember him?
Mm-hmm.
And that guy, Charlie. I can't remember his name, but he was on Saturday Night Live.
Charles Fleischer?
No, black guy. And these were all street performers.
Yeah.
And he died young. But and then there was another guy. These black guys who were street performers. These guys were not writers. They were just, they're trying to street perform to get money. I think it's called, what do they
busking.
Call it? Stir, bu-
busking.
What do they call it?
Busking. Yeah.
And these guys would come to the Improv because they did something. They were on some show. Something happened where they got a lot of attention, and the whole industry would come to watch them. And, you know, you knew that room was like full of like a quarter of heavy hitters, people that could just okay anything. And that's enough to scare anybody out of their shoes. But these guys, because they were so used to performing on the streets and nothing through them, they would shine and they got everything. So, yeah. So their writing ability, I don't know what their writing ability was, but certainly their fear factor was zero. Zero.
Right. Charlie Barnett.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Rick Avilas. Do you remember that name?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So when I started in Boston in 1975, Rick Avilas was in New York, but he would come up, excuse me, and hang out in Boston, and we would do these gong shows. Him, Teddy Bergeron, does that name ring a bell?
V-I-I, the Roman soldiers falling in, right? Yeah.
Teddy's one of the greatest. Very, very sick right now.
Oh.
I'll have an update hopefully soon. But I stay in touch with him because I started with Teddy. This is 1975 when there was nobody doing comedy. But Rick Avilas would come up from New York, and he was another one of these. The first time I met Rick, it was on a subway in Boston, and I didn't know him. And I just heard somebody. He used to do Red Fox, Wolfman Jack, and he would just walk up and down the streetcars and, you know, get money from people because he was just so spot on and very smiley. So he didn't scare people at all. And then he showed up on the comedy scene then, and he lit up the room. He was just great. Again, no writing ability, but just an amazing presence and a great mimic.
Well, Red Fox and Wolfman Jack are the same voice.
Yeah, he did have a very raspy voice, but he was just super. I mean, there was no place to perform in 1976, 77. The comedy connection didn't really start until late 70s, maybe 78. I can't remember. I think like 78. So we would just go to coffee houses, and we would go to these things called gong shows. They were very popular, and they would be held at this restaurant chain around Boston called Ground Round, the Ground Round. And what they would do is they'd have a house band, and the house band would give you the cymbal. So you'd put the cymbal to like three drunken people in the audience, and they would be the judges, and they had this drumstick where they would hit the gong if they didn't like you. And it would be me, Teddy, Rick Avilas, and then various people singing and all this stuff. And I used to get gonged. I would say, "Hi, I'm Bruce Smirnoff." Bang, done. And we sometimes would have to, take buses to get to these gong shows. It would take so long, and I'd get gonged within just saying my name. So I never went over. But Teddy and Rick Avilas were superstars. He used to rotate of who would win. One or the other would always win.
When are you going on your next cruise ship?
Did I lose you?
Are you there?
There. Oh, I'm sorry. I turned my speaker down. Did you? You heard all that,
yes,
right?
Yes, of course. When is your next cruise?
I don't go out till October.
Okay. Good. So we should do this once a week.
Okay.
I'm getting very positive feedback.
Wonderful.
Your stories are great, and it cheers me up.
Good.
Tell
me. Are we off the air?
No. Tell me one more story, and then we'll wrap it up.
Okay. So I wanted to just show you the ups and downs of life, because show business has obviously a lot of downs that we don't see, but when we see the ups, it's sensational. But I'm working in Atlantic City, I believe it's 1991, and I'm in this I'm in a review show called Swing, 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 which is singers and dancers. I come out in the middle, and I do 10 minutes while the dancers are resting backstage. Right. That's a funny story. But that's another day. But the reason I want to tell the story is at night I would leave my show and I'd go over to one of the hotels, and there was a singer named Sonny Averona. And he was like a man in his mid-50s, and he was like a crooner and a jazz guy, like a very, very, very influenced by Sinatra. And I would go and watch his show, and I introduced myself to him, because I was in this review show for like 6 weeks. So I would go there every night, and I became friendly with him. And he was a man who had like a automotive business in Philadelphia, transmission, something like that. So he had a successful life as this man in the automotive business, but this was his passion in life. And he would sing, cuckoo, cray, whatever. And it was really cool. And he had a following from Philadelphia, and these people would come. And then sometimes he would ask me to get up and do 5 minutes. So I would get up and tell jokes. And I felt really cool, because it was that, it was a real, it was a mafia crowd, basically, is what I'm trying to say. It was like a real gangster. It was really cool. And so right near the end of my gig was in May. And he goes, "Hey, kid, come over here." I said, "What?" He goes, "You're not going to believe this, but I didn't want to tell anybody until tonight." And he goes, "The New York Times has been following me for a few weeks, and they're writing a front page article about me going from the automotive business to now having my own room in Atlantic City." I went, "Congratulations, front page New York Times Sunday section of the whatever it's called, the Arts and Leisure." I said, "It's fantastic." And I congratulated him. And then I left on that Sunday, and he died that night. So the article came out the next day, and he died. I mean, he was dead before the article came out. Isn't that weird?
What did he die of?
Like a heart attack. You can look it up. Sonny Averona, Averona, and you'll read his obituary. I think you can still find the article. But yeah, I mean, you talk about, you're going to be on the front page of the Arts and Entertainment, or Arts, what is it called, Sunday Star?
Yeah.
Arts and Entertainment of the New York Times, and you die the night before. And it was just natural cause. He must have smoked, whatever it was. And I just always remember that, he got the break, and he wasn't around to reap the benefits of it. So there's your irony.
Yeah. Do you ever feel you get what you want?
I don't know. What do you mean by that?
Where you get to a place in your career that you probably wanted.
To die?
Not to, no, no, not that, no. But I'm talking about, instead of regretting what could have been, do you ever say, actually, this isn't so bad. It was kismet. I was supposed to.
Yeah, I mean, I say that all the time, but I don't believe it. No, I mean, you know, I mean, I deal with where I'm at. And believe me, I live a great life. It's enviable. I understand that. But to me, it was, you know, like Avi was at this thing last night. I guess Mel Brooks, Carl Reiner, Dick Van Dyke, they were giving some lecture in L.A. And Avi put a little bit of a clip of it up on Facebook today. I mean, I know this sounds weird sitting in my underwear here in Delray Beach, Florida, but I mean, I wanted to be one of those people. I thought I really thought I was cut in the cloth because, you know, you just, all comics feel that way.
What did you think when you moved to Los Angeles? What did you think was going to happen?
Well, I thought I was going to get a sitcom like everybody else. That was 1978 when I moved here. I really have a great look. I'm still funny. I have a funny, you know, look. Mm-hmm. But I never put in the time, and I don't know how to act.
Did you play it out? I mean, did you play it out? Did you say, all right, I'm going to get a sitcom, and from the sitcom...
I didn't have to. When I came out there, I got all this stuff thrown at me immediately because of my look. So, you know, Mitzi, discovered me having coffee with Mitchell Walters next to the Comedy Store, and I hadn't even tried to get on at the Comedy Store. She wanted me on stage, and an agent got with me immediately and sent me out for TV shows. And then I got that Archie Bunker show thing. I got all this stuff, but it all imploded because I had no ability. I mean, I had the look, but I wasn't developed.
So you had the look. That's interesting. So you had the look. You come out to L.A. and they immediately start.
Immediately, because you're the new face. It's a good face. And but then.
How long had you been doing stand-up when you came to LA?
Well, technically since 1975, but in Boston you had no place to go on. And like I said, sometimes I would go on stage and I would be booed off or gonged off within moments.
So you were a baby. You moved to LA as a baby.
22, on my 22nd birthday.
So you're 20, you're 22, and
I'm 22, and I'm getting these parts and auditions, and they're actually giving me the parts, but then I don't know what I'm doing. So I'm, you know, that comes the Archie Bunker thing, and I'm failing miserably. And then once you fail, then you get labeled. So at I'd say by 24, I was labeled whatever, you know, done, not good, can't act, isn't funny, blah, 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 good look, but that's it. So then I stayed in L.A. and I was able to cobble together a real live act, and then went on the road. I did everything ass backwards. And then when I got really good, I almost had a second, you know, with that one man show that we talked about, mm-hmm. One of your episodes. So I almost was able to turn it on its tail, but I was not able to. So, there was a definite detriment to going to Los Angeles before you're ready.
Too much too soon.
Way too much too soon. Yep. And then when you get pronounced done, as you know, you're done. You know, you're cooked.
Is that really true, or is it psychological?
Well, it didn't stop me from trying to develop, but it shut all the doors. I couldn't get agents. I went to all these fancy acting classes, and I tried to turn everything around, but again, I couldn't.
What was the happiest moment during that period?
I would say, blah, 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 blah. I guess it was when I was able to take all the failures of my career in Los Angeles and then turn it into the one-man show and then have a packed theater. You know, granted, it was a 55-seat theater, but every night I performed the show, it was standing room only. Some nights I had to put people, you know, on the stage. We had to put chairs on there, and killing. And I'd have celebrities coming to the show. And it would be so exciting to have people come up to me and go, you know, I used to see you hang out at the Improv. I mean, you seem like a nice guy, but I never took you seriously. I never watched you perform. But, you know, now I think you're terrific. And that was very nice. One time I get this guy come up to me. I had, you remember Danny Robinson? That's Bud's son. Danny mm-hmm. Robinson came to see my show. He's with APA. And all these people came to see me this one particular night after the LA Times article. And they come out at the end of the show, and they're shaking my hand and going, this was really good. And all of a sudden, this man about 60 years old, he pushes them all aside, a man who like had authority. I didn't know who he was, but he just bled authority from his pores. And he pushed Danny Robinson away. Bernie Young was there, Rosie O'Donnell's guy, and pushed him off to the side. He goes, I'm Cy Sussman. I'm with William Morris. Are you represented by anybody?
Sussman.
Did you know Cy Sussman?
No, I love the name, though.
He had the name. Yeah, I'm Cy Sussman.
Did he have a toupee? Please tell me he had a toupee.
No, but he had thinning hair. Oh. He goes, I'm Cy Sussman. I'm with William Morris. Who represents this show? And I just, I kind of angled my way away from Danny and away from Bernie. And I just went, nobody. He goes, does Jeff Witches know about this show? I went, I really don't know. I've been calling his office. Okay, I know Jeff. I am calling tomorrow. We are going to handle you across the board. I want this show. I want you as an actor, and I want you as a stand-up. And then if he had said, I also want to go to the Palm right now and have a 12-pound lobster, I would have said, absolutely, let's get in the car. So that was one of the highest highs, because just that whole moment. And then I go home, and of course I couldn't sleep, but he told me to call Jeff Witches, you know, in the morning. And I waited till like 10:30, so the guy would have his morning coffee, and I call William Morris, Jeff Witches, please, Bruce Smirnoff. So Jeff Witches' office. I go, hi, it's Bruce Smirnoff. Cy Sussman told me to call Jeff Witches.
Cy Sussman.
And she goes, one moment, please. And 2 seconds goes by. Hey, Bruce, it's Jeff. Hi, Jeff. I go, listen, I am totally clued in on your show. I have it written down, send someone from the office to come down and see it. But I got to tell you one thing. Cy Sussman is our projectionist. I go, absolutely. He projects all the projects that come to William Morris. He goes, no, you don't understand. Cy Sussman. He runs the movie projector in the screening room. I got screwed. Oh my God. That was a bad day. Oh, is that a bad day? Oh my God. And he, is that funny? Cy Sussman.
Cy Sussman. Oh, and the happiest moment while you were in the thick of it in your early 20s.
I'd have to say when the LA Times article came out, you know, because I knew it was coming out Thursday calendar. Sunday calendar is the biggest.
Cy Sussman.
Yeah. Thursday calendar is also very big. So I waited until what is that called, the Bulldog? Is that the first? It comes out about 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning. This is back in 1990.
Right, the Bulldog edition. Yeah.
And I guess reading that article, I don't know. There were a lot once things were going well with the show. I had a lot of meetings at networks.
Well, but that was the review of your show.
It was an article about my show.
I'm talking about the thick of 22-year-old Bruce Smirnoff coming to L.A.
Well, that's the Archie Bunker story, you know. I mean,
no, I'm asking for the happiest moment.
Well, the happiest moment is when I got the part. You know, I mean, highs are always accompanied by lows in my career. So that's
we'll talk about that next week.
Okay.
Can you imagine being a child actor? You were 22, 23. When things go really wrong in Hollywood, and they always do, and you look into the abyss and you have to summon up the courage to go on. Right? I mean, you come to Hollywood, anybody who comes to Hollywood does not leave unscathed because you're chasing something you need, something you want. But it just isn't right for the most part, right?
Yeah. I mean, but the only thing I can say is that I listened to, I guess, throughout my life, I listened to people like you and I discussing. So when you listen rationally to people talk like this, you know there has to be lows before there's highs. And then when there's highs, there has to be lows. It's just the cycle of life. And some of the acting classes I was in, they always warn you. I mean, this is, I think, what did get me through the Carol O'Connor thing, was that they always said stuff happens and you can't let it get to you. So That's how I was able to write the one-man show, is that I just absorbed all these horrible stories that happened to me. I just figured that they happened to everybody. So I would tell them on the road, you know, 1987, I would tell them to a comic in the middle of Phoenix, Arizona, in a Dunkin' Donuts. And they would go, no, this never happened to me. None mm-hmm. of these things that you're talking about. And then I realized maybe I had something special. But yeah, I just assumed that everybody went through that. Childhood stars, a lot of them, when they hit a certain, look at Spanky and all the Little Rascals, the kids that we grew up watching as little, you know, we just thought they were eternal stars. But when these people hit 13, 14, they were done.
They're done. Luckily, the only good thing about being a child actor is your body changes and you're unrecognizable. So your fame disappears and you can get on with your life, supposedly, if you can survive.
Except for Jackie Cooper. He survived it all.
Right.
I guess a few more, but he was able to, as his body changed, he was fine.
Right. How about being 40 and famous? Everybody knows who you are, and you're doing something that sucks, and everybody's saying it, and you know it sucks, and you know that you walk into a room and everybody knows that you're on something, on some show that sucks. And it's about to be canceled.
Yeah.
That's got to be really hard.
I can't put myself in that position, so I'll have to go along with you on that.
Don't you think that's very isolating? Don't you think it makes you very hard on the inside?
I guess when you're getting out of your Mercedes, you know, and going into the Palm, you're twitching, but you're still getting out of your Mercedes and going into the Palm. You know, I mean, I don't know. I mean, how many good things on TV? First of all, it's all subjective anyway, but how many things that you're very critical, I'm very critical. How many shows do you watch on TV? I watch none. I watch Fargo. You know, that's it. I think Fargo and Narcos. Those are the only two things I watch on TV.
I think it's better now.
Television is phenomenal now. It's fantastic. It's unbelievable.
No, I'm talking about mental health for famous people. I think that if you're an actor and you're on a show that sucks and nobody's watching it, it's less of a humiliation because if nobody's watching it, nobody knows about it.
Give me a show that you thought sucked.
I would say, if you were, I don't want to name names.
Okay.
I'm not Elia Kazan. The point I'm making is in the 70s and the 80s, up until about 2005, you could be famous and you'd get on a big network show and you would fail publicly. Now, even Tim Allen, his show just got canceled. Last Man Standing on ABC. Did you know it was on?
No. No,
I didn't know it was on until I heard it was canceled. I think that's a healthier way for actors to become famous because, you know, there was a time when we knew who the stars were. Now you're less likely to be humiliated from your failure. I don't know if I could handle. I don't think I'm capable. I don't think I have the constitution to suddenly become famous, have it taken away from me, which always happens, and then have to fight for it back, and then have it taken away from me and fight for it back. These movie stars, it's schizoid. It's manic depression. One year you have a hit movie, the next year it's a flop, and I don't know how they do it.
If they're smart, you take your money and you don't pee it away and you invest it there's other things in life. I mean, there's people, you know, you watch a movie that you really like and you go, I wonder whatever happened to that actor. And of course we Google it and you see the guy, you know, you can look at his whole resume and then you see he fell out around whatever, 1999. But then you see he bought a winery or he, you know, got Fess into
Parker.
Racing cars. And these people have great lives. They have good investments and they live a good life.
Randolph Scott.
He had a good life?
Yeah, afterwards.
Yeah.
Don't put your kids into show business.
Never. Absolutely. It's so bad. So I see it down here. You know, you see it on Facebook. People dress their kids up and they encourage them to do. And I just go, boy, what are they doing? They have no idea what they're getting their kid involved with, especially if the kid gets any kind of modicum of success. Then you've really set off the kid.
A woman and her husband called me.
Yeah.
About 2 years ago. And they had, at the time, a 12-year-old son who was acting and funny and they wanted me to help. And I knew I wasn't going to do it, but I took the call. And I listened for 20 minutes. And we really think he's going to make it, and we want to move now because he's 12 and he's still cute. And I listened, and I said, I'm not interested, but I'll give you some advice. I'll give you some really good advice. And they go, oh, yeah, what is it? I said, get a job.
Yep.
You get the job. Let him be a kid. But he's so talented. But go get a job. You know, they're pimps is what they are. They're pimps.
Yeah. I mean, well, they're living vicariously through the child. And I don't think they understand what can happen, period.
They're pimps. Bruce Smirnoff is our Miami bureau chief. We'll check in with you next week.
Thank you very much, David.